We'll be considering a general framework for ordinary differential equations, which is that you've got n states, I'll call them x1 through xn, and let's just think of this as a point in Rn. We will write x1 dot, so x1 dot means dx1 dt. I'm going to use the over dot notation. So this means how does x change with time? And this will be a function of not just x1, but all of the other variables. And then same for x2. x2 dot will be f2, some other function of all of the variables, all the way down to xn dot. These functions, f1 through fn, depend on the problem. But this whole system of equations, we could call we'll call this an nth order system, and maybe a system like, we're not going to jump to n equals huge, because the right hand side doesn't depend on time. These are called time independent, or that's also called autonomous. So that means the FIs don't depend explicitly on t. And in this class, we'll mostly look at that type of system because it allows us to look at the geometry. Even if we did have the Fs that did depend on time, you could turn it into an autonomous system by just adding on t. How does t evolve in time? And dt by dt, or t dot equals one. So we could add that on if we wanted to, but we're mostly going to stick with this autonomous setting. It's not going to be a big limitation, I don't think. A system that could be written in this form, there's this example we sometimes talk about called the damped harmonic oscillator. And lots of behaviors described by this. Often what's drawn is like a mass that's also got a damper attached to it. So this is a damper. And then this is a spring. And if we look at how this mass shifts from its equilibrium, let's call this variable X, then this would be written in terms of, from mechanics, we would write this. The damper is taken into account through B. That's the effect of the damper. M is the mass, so it's the effect of inertia. And K is the effect of the spring, or the restoring force. So you'll notice this is a second order. We've got a second order ODE. It's not yet in this form up here. So how would we put it in that form? Well, we would define some new variables. So this second order ODE can be put in form above. By defining some variables. So we'll define X1 equals X, and then X2 equals dx dt, which is the same as x1 dot. And then if we write that, then in some sense, x1 dot equals x2 is our first ODE. And we have m dx dt squared, which is the same as x2 dot, plus bx2 plus kx1 equals zero. So we're just rewriting a thing up above, but in terms of our new variables, x1 and x2. So if you want, x1 is defined as x, x2 is defined as this. So it's defined as x1 dot. And then we could rewrite this. So now this is x2 dot equals minus b over m x2 minus k over m x1. So if I put in x1 dot equals x2, this is in the form of what we have above. And this system is said to be linear because all of the terms here on the right-hand side are just functions of the first power. So if that's the case, then that means this ODE is said to be linear, right? Because the right-hand side is linear in X1 and X2. If this is not the case, then the system is said to be nonlinear. And there are tools for solving ODEs that are linear. So we can solve them in closed form. So I guess that's an important thing. Can be solved in closed form. And what do we mean by that? If something can be solved in closed form, that means that you could write x1 as a function of time, x2 as a function of time, given initial conditions, x1 at time zero and x2 at time zero. That's what's so nice about linear things. The problem with nonlinear things is you can't do that. If instead of this damped harmonic oscillator, instead of that, we had a pendulum. And here I'll write, it's kind of weird, but I will write the angle as X, which is going to be highly offensive to some people. But a pendulum, so swinging back and forth under gravity, the dynamics from that are x double dot plus g over l. L is the length. The mass of this thing actually cancels out. So all you have is acceleration due to gravity and l. And then this is a sine x equals zero. Right now, it's not terribly important how we get this. Just sort of take it on faith. This is the equation of motion for the pendulum. So if we use the same approach as we did above, we would get x1 dot equals x2, x2 dot equals negative g over l sine x1. So this is nonlinear, which means closed form solution is hard or impossible. For the pendulum, it's just hard. It's not impossible. But for systems of higher dimension, it becomes impossible. So instead of trying to solve for something in closed form solution, what Poincare suggested, and this is where we'll end, we would try to use geometric techniques to find out the possible solutions, behaviors. So this is taking this view that, okay, look at the space that we call the phase space of the variables, and starting with some initial condition, can we determine where this initial condition evolves to after some time, or at least even constraints on that. So that's the geometric view that Poincare ushered in, and we'll kind of continue that next time.